Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Shelley Meitzler, Community Programs Manager East at the Tuberous Sclerosis Alliance and your moderator for today's e-webinar series topic, TSC-associated neuropsychiatric disorders, also known as TANDs, and we'll be discussing ADHD and OCD. I want to thank our presenting sponsor of the 2021 e-webinar series, Greenwich Biosciences. The TS Alliance will host monthly educational webinars on a variety of TSC-related topics of interest featuring known experts in the TSC community. These free one-hour presentations include an open question and answer period. This series is composed of educational webinars focusing on four topic areas: life stages of TSC, which would include epilepsy, tumor growth, skin manifestations, and education; transition workshops; TSC-associated neuropsychiatric disorders; and research updates and clinical trials. I'll go over a few housekeeping items and then we'll get started. First, everyone's microphone will be muted throughout each presentation. Questions for our speaker can be submitted via the chat box. We will do our best to answer as many questions as time allows. In addition, this webinar is being recorded. The camera setting by default has been turned off for all participants. We encourage you to participate on camera if you feel comfortable doing so, but please keep your camera off if you do not want to be on the recording. Dr. Capal is an associate professor of pediatrics and neurology. She is board certified in pediatrics, neurology with special qualification in child neurology and neurodevelopmental disabilities. She recently joined UNC, where she has a joint appointment in neurology and the Carolina Institute for Developmental Disabilities. Her clinical and research interests focus on children with neurodevelopmental and neurogenetic conditions, including autism spectrum disorder, tuberous sclerosis complex, and Angelman syndrome. She is involved in several research studies funded by the National Institute of Health and TSC Clinical Research Consortium, including determining biomarkers for autism spectrum disorder in infants and young children with TSC and examining common features of ASD among different single gene disorders with high prevalence of ASD. She has transitioned to UNC Chapel Hill with a vision to improve care for individuals with TSC. She has also started a TAN clinic. She has always had a passion for individuals with neurodevelopmental disabilities, helping them and their families navigate the medical system, providing continuity and comprehensive care, and learning from them. Her ultimate career goal is to be a leader in the field of neurodevelopmental conditions and to integrate what can be learned from single gene disorders, such as tuberous sclerosis complex, to understand more about the underlying molecular pathways involved and in turn discover new treatments. I'm now going to go ahead and turn the presentation over to Dr. Capal. Thank you.
All right, welcome everybody. Thank you for taking the time out of your day to listen to me. Please put your questions in the chat box. We do have time at the end to answer your questions and have a really good discussion. I've been asked today to speak about TAND, particularly ADHD and OCD. So I've done no disclosures that are relevant to this talk. So some of the objectives that I'd like to hit today are learning about some of the TAND symptoms that are related to ADHD and OCD, discuss what is ADHD, and then under a broader umbrella, talk about executive dysfunction. And then we'll discuss obsessive compulsive disorder. So when we think about TAND and how that relates to ADHD, so on the TAND checklist, we have several items that are asked, and a few of them are overactivity, hyperactivity, restlessness, and impulsivity. And those behaviors overlap to form what we call an overactive impulsive cluster. Overactivity, restlessness, and impulsivity are the most commonly reported TAND behaviors, as I'm sure some of you, it's not surprising. These are commonly, when we think about these behaviors, we think about ADHD, but these can also be seen in other disorders, such as anxiety disorders. It can be seen in individuals with intellectual disability, autism spectrum disorder, and then executive dysfunction. So what do I mean by overactivity and hyperactivity? So this describes really a pattern most often seen in children, but it can be seen in older individuals. This is a very fidgety, squirmy, difficulty sitting still, lots of running, climbing, most of the time climbing on things they shouldn't be climbing on, excessive motor activity not modified by social context or demands. And what I mean by that is, it's normal for a kid to run around on the playground, but when they're in class, we expect them to sit down and, listen to what the teacher is saying. So difficulty remaining seated, this could be at school. It could also be at the workplace. Difficulty playing or working quietly. These kids are often very loud in what they do. They may also talk excessively. And then in teens and adults, that hyperactivity is often replaced by this feeling of just restlessness. So you may not see the overt hyperactivity, but there's still that internal feeling like you're just not comfortable. So when we think about impulsivity, it's more of this acting before you think. My high school chemistry teacher, I'll never forget, he put it beautifully. He's like, you kind of need to roll that around in your head a little bit before saying it. You know, it's that thing where we often stop and think before we do something. And impulsivity is that part is gone and you just do it. So these people will often blurt out answers, may have difficulty taking turns in conversation, difficulty waiting his or her turn in line, interrupting, intruding. That could also be invading personal space. These behaviors can often cause safety concerns. So we often ask about, do they run out into the street or the parking lot before, looking both ways, or do they touch like a hot stove or something that they shouldn't without thinking that, well, maybe that's dangerous. And so this may also result in poor judgment. So when you think about adults that may do things impulsively, we always joke around like, impulse buying and things like that. But a lot of time, many adults have trouble with kind of thinking things through before moving on with something. And so those things may often result in, a poor outcome. So the tuberous sclerosis registry to increase disease awareness is an international disease registry. And this registry was designed to address these knowledge gaps in the natural history and management of tuberous sclerosis. They had this huge registry, across multiple countries, and the ages range from birth to 71. And they collected data on TAN data. I do want to make you aware that there was a significant amount of TAN data that was missing. But from what they did report, overactivity was the most reported behavior and was seen in almost half. Impulsivity was very close to that. And then ADHD was officially diagnosed in about 20%. And the diagnosis was most often seen in 6-year-olds, but that range was anywhere from under a year to 38 years. So this is quite a wide range for ADHD. And so as you see here, the overactivity and impulsivity, the rate of those reported symptoms seem to decrease with age. So as you see here in this blue and the gray was most often reported in the 2 to 5 and then the 5 to 9 as well. But as people got older, those the impulsivity stayed kind of high until you hit above 40, but the overactivity decreased significantly in adulthood. So we often think about these symptoms in relation to ADHD, and what that stands for is attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. So ADHD, the definition, it's a childhood onset neurodevelopmental disorder, but this disorder can continue in adulthood, and it often does. There are different types of ADHD, so you can have the inattentive only, you can have the hyperactive impulsive only, or you can have both. This diagnosis is based on meeting behavioral criteria. So you guys might have heard like the DSM or the Diagnostic Statistic Manual. And that's what we use for diagnosis. There are no laboratory imaging or EEG tests that can definitively rule in or out ADHD. But what we've learned is that 70% of school-aged children with ADHD have at least another psychiatric disorder. And that could be anxiety, could be oppositional defiant disorder, obsessive compulsive disorder, tic disorder, and depression. And so when we think about ADHD, it's often not in a vacuum. So we always have to think about these other things. The thing I haven't discussed yet was the inattentive symptoms. So these can often come along with ADHD in the combined type. And also, you know, people have argued that there really isn't just a hyperactive impulsive type, that these kids also have poor attention. So when we think about inattention symptoms, we think about people making careless mistakes, overlooking those details, rushing through their work, difficulty listening to instructions. And often, you know, those instructions gets harder as those instructions get more complex and maybe more of them. Difficulty attending to tasks or activities, failure to follow through with the instructions or tasks that you've been given, difficulty with organization. This often leads to difficulty with time management. And these people tend to avoid or dislike mentally sustaining tasks. So as children get older and the homework gets longer, or at work when the amount of work gets harder and longer, that sustained attention is really where they struggle. People with ADHD often, or inattention symptoms, can lose things. So not paying attention to where they put it in the first place. So they often lose it. Easily distracted, forgetful in daily activities. So things to think about, because we read these lists and we're all like, you know, you can maybe identify, especially with the inattention. I feel like I can identify with a lot of those, but it has to be impairing. And that means it really negatively impacts your social, your academic, your occupational activity, to mean that it is causing so much trouble that you're failing, or that you're, you know, in trouble of losing your job. You are having a hard time making friends. So this really severely impacts your everyday life. It's inconsistent with the developmental level, meaning if I have a child that has developmental delay and they're 5, but their developmental level is about a 3-year-old, well, I shouldn't expect that their attention and activity level should be at a 5-year level. It should be more consistent with a 3-year level. So when you have to kind of look at their attention and activity level based on their developmental level. And so if that's inconsistent, so if they're even more hyperactive and inattentive, even based on their developmental level, that's when you get concerned that maybe it's ADHD. It's persistent. So symptoms need to be present for greater than 6 months. So this needs to be an ongoing thing, not just an adjustment to maybe a new environment or something like that. It's pervasive. So symptoms need to be present in 2 or more settings. So not just at school, or not just at home, or not just with certain friends, but in everything. There has to be some sort of impairment, and not better accounted for by something else. And so when we think about our TSC folks, epilepsy, intellectual disability, lots of other medical issues, medications that can cause side effects. So all those things potentially can contribute to inattentive symptoms or overactivity. And so we have to make sure that those aren't the issue. And a couple things, like having ADHD does not mean that someone is not smart. I just had this conversation with a teenager last week. He's thinking that because he forgets things, he is stupid. And I was like, no. It doesn't mean that you're not smart. It just means that maybe that part of your brain, it functions differently. It has nothing to do with your cognitive ability. So an ADHD is not attention deficit. It's rather attention regulation. People with ADHD, I always have families tell me, well, my kid can play video games and they're just fine. They can, you know, do the things they love to do. It's that regulation. Regulating the attention to the things that need to be paid attention to, and not just those few things that maybe they enjoy. So it's an overall problem. ADHD symptoms change over time and environment. So when you think about structure of school or work setting, that can put demands on your ability to sit still and pay attention. So certain atmospheres may make it harder to do that. Attention demands increase with grade level. So for kids, a lot of times they may be able to do fine without medication in kindergarten, first, second grade, but usually by 4th and 5th grade, when those homework assignments get longer, the reading assignments get longer, that's when things start to really fall off, as far as their grades fall off, they all of a sudden have a lot of trouble. And for adults, when you think about attention demands increase with more things. So your job, having family, kids, other responsibilities. So the more things you have to attend to, and if you already struggle with this, it just makes it that much harder. Novel high reward situations may temporarily improve symptoms. So if a child or even adult is in something brand new or meeting someone for the first time, they may actually look very different than after that kind of novelty wears off. And like I said earlier, overactivity is replaced with a feeling of restlessness and that drive as people get older. Teens and adults can continue to struggle with poor planning ability, really a decreased frustration tolerance, and this emotional lability, so difficulty regulating their emotions for good or for bad. So like I said, the three kind of pillars of ADHD, so you have inattention, hyperactivity, and impulsivity. But there's so many other things that come along with ADHD that a lot of people say, well, it must be something else. It's like, no, it's just the other stuff that comes with ADHD, like emotional dysregulation. You expect a two-year-old to have a temper tantrum. You don't really expect a seven-year-old to. But those kids really have a hard time, you know, controlling that impulse to get really upset, and they don't have the coping skills to be able to regulate that. It's same thing with adults, low frustration tolerance. So they may not have a temper tantrum, but they, you know, they may have a really low frustration tolerance for things. Social impairment. So ADHD causes a lot of social distress. And so we have a lot of kids with ADHD that some people are like, well, are they autistic? Because they don't have friends. It's difficulty reading social cues, you know, the impulsivity. A lot of those things can cause social problems. Sensory dysfunction. So a lot of people with ADHD are sensory seekers. That's why that hyperactivity, the constant touching and the all over the place, that's actually can be soothing. So they're looking for that sensory input. Sleep problems. So if you can't slow yourself down, often have a hard time getting to sleep at night. Poor self-esteem. These kids, and then often going into adulthood, get this, they get labeled as the bad kid. They get labeled, you know, as stupid. So it's really hard always getting corrected. You start to feel like, okay, something's wrong with me. Oppositional defiant behaviors. Like I said, oppositional defiant disorder often goes with ADHD. And then difficulty transitioning. If you can't regulate your attention, you have a really hard time transitioning to the next thing. So how about ADHD specifically in TSC? And so there has been some literature about this in specifically in TSC. And so what we see is that ADHD occurs in about 30 to 50% of individuals with TSC. It's 10 times more prevalent than in the general population. The rates are slightly higher in individuals with developmental delay and intellectual disability. And there is a significant overlap with other TSC comorbidities. So autism spectrum disorders, developmental delay, intellectual disability, epilepsy. So we see this overlap in lots of these other conditions. They've tried to look at risk. So potentially frontal lobe epilepsy or EEG abnormalities, potentially TSC2 mutations, but there's some conflicting literature. But one thing we do know is that individuals with TSC are at risk for overall executive dysfunction. And so what do I mean by executive dysfunction? So this is kind of a side view of your brain. This is an MRI. There's your brain stem and your spinal cord. There's your nose and your mouth and your tongue, just to give you guys a reference. And this is your frontal lobe, okay? And the frontal lobe really is responsible for what we call executive functioning. What that is directing your attention to what needs to be directed to. Regulating your emotions, controlling impulses, keeping track of information to complete a task, and we call that working memory, multitasking, planning, organizing, self-monitoring. So understanding your own, yourself into how you are, you know, kind of reflecting about your own behavior in reference to others, and then anticipating a consequence from behavior. So all of those things are very important, all of those things can be disrupted in TSC. So what is executive dysfunction? It's sort of a dysfunction in all of those things. So difficulty controlling your emotion, showing self-restraint, A real difficulty with goal-directed behaviors. So talking to a lot of adults with normal IQ and TSC really have trouble kind of organizing their life and saying, I want to do this. And so this is how I'm going to do it. And this is the goal I'm going to have. And then I'm going to monitor it along the way to make sure I get there. And if I don't, this is what's going to happen. I find a lot of adults struggle with this. And so they even may be able to perform individual parts of a task, but you throw it all together. And then that's where things start to really get difficult. Difficulty with problem solving, time management, decision making. And so you can see how this is really difficult when you're working and you're having to manage a family, and all of these things really play into what we do every day. Like I said before, difficulty multitasking, and then stress, fatigue, boredom can all make this worse. So a few things to think about when we think about how to treat this. So we have a few principles. The most important things are, you know, keeping a consistent routine. So if you have a hard time with kind of planning and organizing your day, if your routine is consistent, it's kind of one less thing you have to think about. It's almost becomes like a rote activity. Breaking tasks into smaller tasks, because these big tasks can be overwhelming, break them into smaller ones. Make information external. So if you need to put sticky notes, lists, phone apps, put everything outside of your brain so you can access it easily. Make time external. So, you know, put a timer on your computer, put a timer on your phone, make it so that you can keep track of those things, even and for your children too. And then develop accountability to others to help reach their goals. So don't do this by yourself. And at the bottom here, I have some websites that help with some of these organization strategies. So this is the ADHD organization, chadunderstood.org. And then Russell Barkley is a psychologist that publishes a lot of these different principles. And I'm happy to kind of share them with you all if you don't get a chance to write it down. So the most common thing we do initially is strategies. So environmental strategies. I've broken them down into a couple different areas. So first, let me talk about environmental strategies at school. So when we talk, you know, a lot of times in your IEP or 504 plan, this gets implemented. So placing the child close to the teacher and away from distractions, providing verbal or physical cues to stay on task, visual schedules. So the more you give them ways to integrate their schedule, not just verbal, but visual, it helps them to remember what they have to do. Teachers should frequently check in to see if the child actually understands the instructions to make sure they don't get lost. Graphic organizers for older kids and teenagers can help. Chunk assignments. So, you know, if you have a big project, break it into smaller chunks so that it's easier to do. For worksheets, like a math worksheet, and they have 50 problems on a worksheet, cover up most of them and only have them see, you know, one problem or a few problems at a time so they don't get overwhelmed. And then lots of motor breaks. These kids need movement. So as a part of their IEP or 504 plan, allow them to get up out of their seat and walk around for 5 minutes. At work, so same thing for adults and teenagers and adults. Keep your workspace clean and clutter-free. It definitely helps. If you keep that organized, it kind of helps you keep track of things. Again, break work tasks into smaller, manageable tasks. So I always think about a recipe. If someone gives you a project at work and they say, this is what you need to do, and it's just like, wow, this is really overwhelming. Well, a recipe tells you what you need, and it tells you the steps, and it has them in order. So kind of set up tasks like that. Get, you know, write down what you need, write down what you need to do, and then break it down into steps. It makes it much easier to go through to the end instead of getting overwhelmed. If you're frustrated, do something that you're good at for 10 to 15 minutes and then return to the more challenging task. So there's been research on people who do an activity that they fail at and then they go and take a test versus those same, a different group does something and they win at it and then they go and take a test. The people who did something and they won at it ahead of time do much better on the test. So it's like a confidence booster. So like if you just take a break, listen to music, go shoot a couple hoops, do something that kind of builds your confidence, and then come back to the challenging task. And then also, you know, set achievable, realistic, and specific goals. So we all, at the beginning of January, it's like a perfect time, like, I'm going to lose weight, I'm going to exercise. Well, what does that mean? So set something achievable, set a realistic goal, and it has to be specific. I am going to, you know, cut down soda, you know, during the week, and then I'm only going to have one soda on the weekend. Like, that is realistic, it's specific, and it's achievable. So think about that instead of giving really kind of nebulous goals for yourself and for your kids, actually. And then environmental interventions at home. So again, for your kids, use simple, clear, specific, and consistent commands. So if you tell your kid with ADHD, go clean your room, they're going to walk into the room and nothing is going to happen because it's too nebulous. Say, this is a list. I need you to make your bed. I need you to pick your clothes up off the floor. I need you to put your toys in the box. Very concrete, very specific. And it's more likely to get done. Again, you'll see this over and over again. Break up tasks into smaller steps. In terms of homework, consistent time and a consistent space for homework. Frequent reminders to bring home and your assignments and complete them. Calendars, daily planners. And most importantly, for everyone, praise the positive behaviors and effort. This is not something that they're doing on purpose. It's difficult. And so praise the effort, even if it's not perfect, but they're trying. Some strategies to help with emotional dysregulation. So provide stability and consistency. People who don't know what's coming up, that have a lot of chaos, really often don't know how to regulate their emotion. So if you can combine, provide consistency, it helps the person to know what to expect. Recognize your child's or your emotions and responses are not intentional. Talk about your feelings, provide words and labels. So I often talk to my families of kids that are younger to say that they may scream and yell and stuff because they don't have a word to describe how they're feeling. So give them a word. You know, when my kids were little, we called it emotionals, like, because they just couldn't explain what it meant. So give them a word. And so they can replace tantrums with words. And I think even in adults, this would be helpful to maybe try to understand how you're feeling and talk about it. Model positive coping strategies. If they see you doing positive strategies when you're having a hard time, then that's how they learn. This is not something that comes naturally. Teach how to use positive self-talk, which is really important. We often don't talk to ourselves or about ourselves very nicely, and our kids hear that. Teach relaxation and calming techniques. So teach them self-soothing activities, praise the effort. And then finally, a remote control example. So if a kid hauls off and smacks their sibling, and you know it was out of pure impulse, then you take a remote control that doesn't work. And you could say, okay, I'm going to push the rewind button and we're going to practice. How do you do this? How would you have done this differently? And they have a chance to do it over. And so it's practice on how you would do it differently. We definitely need to talk about medication because there is a place for them. Medications are used when environmental interventions alone are not enough. And so we have two classes for ADHD. So we have stimulants and non-stimulants. The stimulants are two classes, methylphenidate and amphetamines. And these are first line medications to treat ADHD. They're extremely effective. They work quickly. They are kind of go on quickly and they come off the same day, either they have short or long acting. So a couple hours or, you know, up to 12 hours. And the advantage is you only take them when you need them. So you can take breaks on weekends or holidays or things. So you don't need to take them every day. Non-stimulants, so we have a few different kinds. So we have guanfacine and clonidine, and those are called alpha-2 agonists. And these are often used off-label in preschool ages. The Intuniv, which is a long-acting guanfacine, is FDA-approved for ADHD. So we use these for younger kids. And they often also, we use clonidine a lot to help with sleep. Atomoxetine, or Strattera, is used in ADHD. It's FDA-approved for kids over age 6, and that's used for those whom stimulants are maybe not effective or maybe not tolerated. It may also help with anxiety, and these medications you need to take every day. So what are the effects? I always tell families, The effect of the medication is to decrease core ADHD symptoms, inattention, hyperactivity, impulsivity. We're not expecting them to treat other things necessarily, but if you treat these, you can sometimes see improvements in noncompliance. The impulsive aggression, like I said, smacking your sibling without thinking. Social interaction, because they're slowing down a little bit and able to interact better. And in certain settings, we have seen improvements in productivity, academic productivity, and academic accuracy. So when you choose, so this is some research done on the stimulants, they found that about 70 to 75% will have a beneficial response to any stimulant you give. So a lot of people will say, well, which one do you recommend? Often it doesn't matter. It may be what you're most comfortable with. So if you ask 10 different doctors, they may all have their favorites. The one you pick first doesn't necessarily matter. There are several that will work. And then we also know that over 90% will respond if you've tried either like both the methylphenidate and the amphetamines. So if the first medicine doesn't work, or even the second one, keep trying until you find one, because you're likely to find one. Note that there are some that may respond to only one class, but not both. And then those, about half, who don't respond to one class will respond to the other. So for stimulants, they do have their side effects. The most common are decrease in appetite, but that is only when the medicine is kind of in there. It goes away once the medicine wears off, and their appetite does rebound. Trouble falling asleep, especially if the dose is too high or given too late in the day. Stomach aches, headaches, some nervousness, and some irritability. So it can kind of bring out some of those things. Studies have shown that side effects tend to be more common with the amphetamines, but this is not always the case, and each person is different. And so it doesn't mean that you shouldn't try those. And then non-stimulant side effects. So for the alpha-2 agonist, the most common one is drowsiness, and that tends to get better with time. Low blood pressure. So we really are careful with what we dose, and you can get some nausea, stomach pain, and constipation, which are not as common. And then with the Strattera, you can get belly pain, dizziness, loss of appetite, nausea, constipation. And as you can see, a lot of medicines will cause these. And very rarely, you can actually develop a rash that causes swelling. That's called angioedema. And one thing, because this is a serotonin norepinephrine reuptake inhibitor, it's kind of in the class where we are really careful to use it in individuals with a bipolar disorder or a history, family history of bipolar disorder. So what are the predictors of increased side effects with these, any of these medicines? So increasing the dose, so higher doses, younger age, which is why we often use behavior therapy before medicine for preschool, and then developmental comorbidities. So like autism and intellectual disability, they're still effective, but maybe they may not be quite as effective as kids without those issues. Okay, so that was a lot on ADHD and executive dysfunction. The next thing I want to talk about is obsessive compulsive disorder. The Tosca-Tan data collected information on obsessions. And so what they did find was they were seen in about 14% and most commonly reported in adults. So this dark gray is your obsessions, kind of low in this group here, but much higher as someone gets older. So obsessive compulsive disorder, what is that? I think we all have a sort of an idea of what it is, but the definition is you have obsessions, which are recurrent thoughts, urges, or fears, and those make you very uncomfortable, and they lead to the compulsion. The compulsion is often repetitive, excessive, and oftentimes irrational or not connected to the obsession, with the goal of preventing the feared event or relieving stress. However, this is very temporary, and overall, the compulsions bring no source of pleasure. So obsessions, there are several that are common. So obsessions with symmetry, and that can lead to compulsions of repetitive counting, ordering of objects. There is a lot of times obsessions with germs and contamination. So that can lead to excessive cleaning. Also, there are obsessions with like forbidden thoughts. So violent thoughts that make, you know, that, you know, I had a patient once that had a violent thought about, you know, pushing somebody out the window. They were afraid they were going to do that, or they're afraid they were going to run somebody over with their car, like very irrational and very uncomfortable feelings, and often religious, like religious persecution. Like, if I do this, I'm going to hell. So things that are very uncomfortable, obsessions about harming someone, obsessions about losing control, and lots of fears about, say, I'm afraid my mother is going to get sick and die. So to prevent this, I'm going to tap on the table 5 times. So it doesn't really make a lot of sense. So some of the compulsions, like I said, you know, repetitive counting, excessive cleaning, lots of checking, the stove, the door, lots of tapping. So people tapping a door handle, tapping a surface, undoing and repeating. So, you know, taking your jacket on and off multiple times, and then hoarding. So compulsions, like I said, do not have to have a logical connection to the obsession. And oftentimes they don't. Compulsions need to take up to at least an hour per day. So one of the things you want to know is like, okay, I compulsively check the door because I'm afraid of something. Well, are you stuck at that door for 3 hours? Like, does it prevent you from leaving your house? And then these, the most important thing is they generate stress and they actually impair overall functioning. So what is not OCD? Because I think we use this a lot, and it's important. And I learned a lot by doing this, was understanding like, what is this? So OCD is not enjoying neatness, cleanliness, and order. So a lot of people say, oh, I'm so OCD, I like my house clean. Well, most of the time when you like your house clean and stuff, it actually makes you feel better when it's done. People who have OCD actually are distressed by the obsession, and the compulsion is to temporarily relieve that, but it actually doesn't. It just causes a cycle. It's very uncomfortable. So other things that often we mistake for OCD is anxiety. So recurrent thoughts or worries for anxiety, but often the things that we do because of it make sense. So I am worried that someone's going to break into my house, so I'm going to lock the doors. Or I am worried that, you know, my mom's not going to pick me up, so I'm going to call her a bunch of times. Those are connected. Versus an OCD, the compulsion is not necessarily connected to the worry or the thought. And then people with anxiety can be particular about order or routine, but it often makes them feel better when they can control their environment because it makes them less anxious. With autism spectrum disorder, we often think of these kids, they have a lot of repetitive interests and a lot of repetitive behaviors and a lot of motor behaviors. And they're also pretty insistent on the sameness. But the difference with autism is a lot of times they do it to soothe themselves. They like it, makes them feel better. And sometimes those things could change. Like they could rock 1 minute, they could flap or they could spin. It's not necessarily tied to anything specific. And then tics. Very repetitive motor and vocal behaviors. And sometimes there's that urge, but tics change, they wax and wane. Oftentimes people with tics don't even know they're doing it. But OCD can often be associated with all these things. So you can have anxiety and OCD. Tics and Tourette syndrome are often associated with OCD. So they can occur together. There's also issues with executive function in OCD. So if you think about it, if you're stuck on the same idea, the same compulsion, you have a really hard time shifting your attention to a new idea. And if you're stuck in this repetitive cycle, you can't prioritize and order the actions you need to do. And it's really hard to stay on task and actually be productive toward goal-related behaviors. What is the treatment? So the treatment is a combination. So often, cognitive behavioral therapy. So the goal is increase the exposure to what causes the problem, but not allow that repetitive behavior to occur. And also allowing people to understand what that compulsion is and really try to understand it so that you can get through it. Medications are often helpful. So there's lots of different kinds, mostly the SSRIs, but medication alone doesn't help. And without treatment or without therapy, the OCD often recurs if you stop the medicine. And then include other lifestyle habits to reduce anxiety, because OCD is very anxiety provoking. You want to make sure to reduce your anxiety. So eating well, exercise, sleep, and then appropriate social support. You can't do this by yourself. You need help. So conclusions. So we've talked a lot about a lot of things, but really I want you guys to understand that people with TSC, they struggle with lots of different neuropsychiatric difficulties, and those can change throughout your life. ADHD is very common in TSC, and executive function deficits are even more common. OCD can occur by itself, but also in combination with other TAN-related diagnoses. And we all know that TAN-related behaviors often co-occur, which can make identification and treatment more challenging. However, treatment exists, and it's important for you guys to talk to your healthcare providers and know and let them know that these can happen in TSC, and they can be treated. So thank you for listening, and I wanted to leave some time for discussion. I really appreciate you guys having me, so I'm going to stop sharing and go to the discussion.
Perfect. Thank you so much, Dr. Capal. That was a wealth of fantastic information, so I do want to allow some time. We got some questions in the chat. The first one that came through, are there meds that don't reduce appetite?
So I would say that either stimulants are definitely the ones that reduce your appetite the most. I would say your non-stimulants are reported to reduce them, but I would say they're more kind of appetite neutral. So if you're really worried about appetite, I would go to the non-stimulants. I've also treated people that really needed stimulants, that really had a hard time not being on them, and giving them a medication to actually increase their appetite while they're on the stimulants. So that's an option for ones that really need to be on them.
Thank you. The next question, what med can be taken with SEPs? And then it looks like they're being more specific as well with Depakote.
Okay. SEP. I'm not sure what SEP is, but Depakote, any of these can be taken with Depakote. There's no contraindication. I'm not really sure what SEP is.
Yeah, I'm not, whoever submitted that question, if you wouldn't mind just elaborating on SEP, we can certainly come back to that as well, just to make sure we address your concern. The next question, is OCD anxiety driven and or higher in puberty for a TSC teenager with ID diagnosis?
So I think OCD often coincides with anxiety. So anxiety definitely makes OCD worse. Okay. And that's why I was saying you need to help the anxiety to help the OCD. So a lot of times anxiety will drive some of those behaviors, but they are two different things, even though the medication to treat them are very similar. And yes, OCD is higher in teenagers and adults. And we, as far as intellectual disability versus not, I don't know if it's necessarily higher in those with intellectual disability. I did not see anything that says it is or isn't. Although I can imagine that, so what we're finding in the TSC is that it's really hard to accurately get a good feel for what kids with and adults with ID actually have, because it's really hard to diagnose some of these things because they're harder to kind of get that information from.
Thank you. Next question, do you have any experience with noticing any effects of Epidiolex on the behaviors?
Sometimes it helps mildly. I know that the drug companies are interested in kind of looking at what the effects of Epidiolex on behavior overall. I can't say that overwhelmingly everyone that's on Epidiolex is all of a sudden their behavior is better. So I think we just don't have enough information about that. And I think behavior is also so different. I mean, when you say behavior, you could mean 100 different things. But I don't necessarily put somebody, so like for example, with Depakote, it's a mood stabilizer. So if I'm worried about someone's mood, I will use Depakote if they have seizures and I also want to control mood. I do not feel that we are there for Epidiolex to say, oh, you have seizures and behaviors, we're going to put you on Epidiolex. So I don't think we're there yet.
Okay. Next question. Are you providing telehealth visits at this time?
So it depends on where you live. So when all of this started, we were able to get temporary licenses in a bunch of different states. Some states don't require physicians to have a state-specific certificate. So it really depends on where you live. I am really hoping that at some point this is going to let up and we're going to have better telehealth guidelines for out of state. So I am happy to kind of talk offline for people, depending on which state you live in, and try to figure something out for you.
Thank you. Next question, what class is Focalin in?
That is a methylphenidate. It's a potent methylphenidate. So it's like in the same class as Ritalin, but the concentration's higher, so the dose isn't, you don't need to give as much.
And this is a question that seems to be coming from a few people or an issue overall. Yeah. We're struggling with skin picking. Is this OCD, anxiety, something else? How do we treat it?
So so skin picking can be due to a lot of things. Now, if you're on a stimulant and you already pick, you're really focused, then you just focus more on the picking. So I find a lot of kids with stimulants tend to pick more if they were going to pick initially, because now they just, that's what they do. Anxiety, yes, definitely. Because it's just there. Sometimes boredom, sometimes sensory seeking. So there's a lot of different things with skin picking, and it's hard to treat because if you're treating all these other things, you hope the skin picking gets better, but sometimes some of your treatments make it worse. The only way it would be OCD is if the skin picking was preceded by a very specific, like a obsession. Like, I'm going to pick my skin to prevent something, or I'm picking it because I'm afraid of something. So I would say it's probably less likely that, unless you have a specific history of that, and more so anxiety, other things. But it is very difficult to treat.
Does OCD and explosive behaviors go hand in hand?
So it can. I think it depends on, so explosive behaviors are often a result of many different things. So when I have people bring their children in to say, my kid has explosive behaviors, we often have to find the root cause of what's the reason. So OCD can be one of those. So if you are really, your compulsion, you know, your obsession is on something and you are, compelled to do something and you can't do it, so then that could cause explosive behaviors. If you're really anxious and you don't know how to communicate your anxiety, you could have explosive behaviors. Executive dysfunction, you do not know how to regulate your behavior, you can have explosive behaviors. If you're super aggressive and irritable, which a lot of these kids are, you can have explosive behaviors. So I think OCD is just one of them, but I wouldn't say they go hand in hand.
It sounds like obsessive tendencies are quite common in TSC, even among those without OCD. Could you please describe strategies for addressing obsessive behaviors, such as perseveration on particular conversational topics?
Yes. So I often see this a lot, especially kids that have kind of autism spectrum behaviors. And in TSC, there's a lot of people that may not quite meet ASD, but have those features. It's very common. So what I often tell families is they can allow the person to talk about their topic for 10 minutes or some circumscribed amount of time, and then they have to move on. Or if they ask the same question over and over again, you're like, you can ask me 2 times and then we're moving on. And so set a limit. Otherwise, that person is going to talk about it all day. So you have to set those boundaries.
And is perseveration on a topic more OCD or ASD-like?
I would say definitely more ASD-like. Now, if OCD, it would be like, I have to say the same 3 words over and over again to prevent or to relieve my obsession. ASD, they have this difficulty because they kind of get stuck on certain things and they have those restricted interests. And so for them, they think everybody else likes the same thing. And so that's kind of, it sort of perpetuates this cycle.
Okay. The next question, my 8-year-old has ADHD and anxiety, more like 6.5 years developmentally. We have been tackling anxiety, but it came to our attention with neuropsych testing that attention is a major problem. She's on guanfacine, but it makes her very sleepy and irritable. Has helped with impulse control. She's also taking short-acting Ritalin only in the morning because she does not eat well. and is experiencing GI issues. Any other specific medications you would recommend to add or adjust?
So she's old enough now that I would recommend trying the longer acting stimulants. You may have fewer side effects and just start at a lower dose. I would try maybe another methylphenidate, there's lots of them. You could do metadate, you could do methylene, you could do, Focalin. And then if you're still experiencing GI issues, then you could try one of the amphetamine classes like Adderall or Vyvanse, things like that. And then if she's having trouble eating, what you want to do is make sure that she has a good breakfast and really eats well before the dose, and then allowing them to eat kind of, once the medication wears off, you hope that kind of rebounds. And then giving them holidays like on weekends and things like that where they may not necessarily need to take the medicine so that they have a chance to kind of have their appetite rebound. But yes, one thing I didn't put that I almost did, but I feel like it was more my own opinion, was that I feel like 10X or guanfacine either works really well or it actually makes behaviors worse. And there really is no in between. So I find sometimes kids get really even more irritable and emotional on the medicine. I haven't really found that anyone's published that, but I've seen it a lot. So, yeah.
Okay. Thank you. I'm going to just switch over quickly to some of the questions we received ahead of the webinar as well. So one of the questions is differentiating between behavior issues that are age appropriate and behaviors that may be specifically related to TSC.
So, and that's difficult. I think a lot of it is really having a good conversation with someone who knows about behavior. Because yeah, I get that question a lot. Like, is my kid just having a temper tantrum or is it because they have TSC? Well, it could be both. So there is I think when we have a child with a chronic disease, we're going to overthink every single behavior that they have. So really talking with someone who knows how to help you differentiate the two, is really important, because I think that's a really difficult question to answer, broadly.
And is there any kind of timeline or specific cues that you would say would help someone kind of determine an appropriate time to switch to medications?
So I always tell families that if the behavior therapy and the interventions that you're doing are not enough, so it's helping, some, but they're struggling in school, they're getting in trouble, like it's just not enough, then I would say, at that point, add medicine. I have some very young children who are just a huge safety risk and really are very destructive. And I put those kids on medicine when it's very clear that they can't even participate in therapy to begin with. So that's a very important conversation to have with your physician.
Okay. What types of interventions or supports can be done following neuropsych testing?
So neuropsych testing is great because it tells us kind of what parts of the brain are affected. People often say, well, can I get an MRI to see what's wrong with my kid? And I was like, well, that only shows you a structure, but neuropsych testing shows function. And so that helps us figure out what's wrong, how we can help. And they often come with a nice long list of interventions. And those things can be shared with the school and then used to develop an individualized education plan.
Okay. Next question, back to the chat is, would you be willing to share the PowerPoint? So I know this webinar is recorded, but yeah. If you'd be willing to share that as well,
sure.
That's okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Happy to.
And another question back to the skin picking, they're on Quillavant. Which class of ADHD medication is that?
So that's methylphenidate.
And so I know that we probably have about 23 more questions. So I want to mindful.
Let me scroll through them really quickly just to see if there's anything. There's a question about contacting me about someone from Europe. Again, I'd be happy to give you some general advice, but unfortunately, telemedicine, we have limits with what we can do. So there are some that people have very specific questions about their children. I'm not sure there's a mechanism. I'm happy to help if there's a way to kind of do that.
Yeah. So I think if it would be okay with you, what we can do is I can maybe follow up with you the questions that we received in the chat, and of course, understanding that they have to be answered in more of that broad understanding as you're not their specific doctor, that can maybe help address some of the more in-depth questions. Yes. And let me just see.
So there is one is, can ADHD medicines make behaviors worse? Yes, they can. Sometimes because they can make you more irritable. And so sometimes you need to treat both. So we have the like explosive ADHD. I often combine ADHD medicine and an atypical antipsychotic like Risperdal. And I find that that works quite well. And that is very common in this group of kids. And then there's a question to share my email. And that can, yeah, we can talk about me. I'm happy to do that.
Okay.
Do I just write in the chat or do you want to share it?
I can share it. I can follow up. We have everyone that registered, so I'm happy to kind of follow up with all of that information with your PowerPoint, your contact information. And again, thank you for being so generous. We want to make sure we address everyone's questions. But again, I want to be very respectful of everyone's time. So I'm just going to put one more, going to share this real quick. And this will again provide a reference for everyone. So again, Dr. Capal, thank you so very much for your time and expertise.
You're welcome.
This was a wealth of information and we truly appreciate it. I want to thank you all for participating today. And of course, thank our participating sponsor of the 2021 e-webinar series, Greenwich Biosciences. And just to let you know, next week, the Life Cycles webinar will take place on Thursday, January 27th. That's going to be Overcoming Hurdles, Insurance, Scripts, and Specialty Pharmacies at 8 p.m. Eastern. And that's going to be presented by Greenwich Biosciences. So to register for future webinar topics and to access recordings like today, please visit www.tsalliance.org/e-webinars for more information. We thank you all for your time and we look forward to seeing you again soon. Thank you very much and have a great night.